Welcome to the Dork Forest. Jackie and her pals will never bore us. Shameless confessions
about our obsessions
will make us laugh and smile. So let's explore the Dork Forest and dork out for a while.
Hello and welcome to the Dork Forest. I'm Jackie Cation. I am your host of the Dork Forest. You probably know the websites, JackieCation.com, DorkForest.com, TheDorkForest.com. We're all over iTunes and whoever has downloaded it and repurposed it for whatever your needs. That's right. So feel free to review the show on iTunes. Feel free to email me, Jackie at JackieCation.com, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns. Anyway, let's do the credits. Mike Rickberg composed and sang that song you just heard. He sang it with his wife, Sarah. He'll sing again his words to the Mexican Hat Dance at the end of the program. Patrick Brady is going to fix this audio, and Vilmos does my website. Okay. There are many ways to support the show. Let's talk about them. The easiest way is just to tell other people about the show and follow me on Twitter and Instagram and Snapchat at Jackie Cation and tell people word of mouth. Another way to support the show financially, doesn't cost you anything, is the Amazon banner. On JackieCation.com, there's an Amazon banner under support the show. And on DorkForest.com, there's just an Amazon link that takes you to Amazon. And both take you to Amazon, you order like normal, and the show gets a little bit of a kickback. Doesn't cost you extra. It's just a way, if you order from Amazon, to help the show. More direct way of helping the show, you can give money to the show via PayPal. There's a PayPal button under the Support the Show page on JackieCation.com, and there's a PayPal button on DorkForest.com. You can donate directly. If you want to give monthly, I haven't made that easy. I don't have a monthly setup. I know that it's easy. I just don't have any time to do it. So you have to remember every month that you like the show and then give me money. So I'll use it wisely on audio cables and chocolate, whatever. Another way to support the show, if you don't like PayPal, is people have been Venmoing me money. I'll take it. That seems lovely. Jackie at JackieCation.com. It's just under Jackie Cation. So whatever. If you have listened to all 600 and whatever episodes of The Dork Forest and would like more Dork Forest, there are premium episodes, probably a dozen of them. And they are, in the last couple of years, if I do a live episode, it usually costs me some money. So I have been putting them up on Bandcamp, and they cost money. They cost $2 a pop. But if you go to thedorkforest.bandcamp.com, you can see those different shows. They're usually live episodes around the world. And there is also four stories on a sort of a handmade storytelling album that I made over there too. And those are just $1 each. So if you want to go to Bandcamp, you can do that as well. You can order merch on JackieCation.com. There are shirts and CDs and a DVD of my stand-up. There's the stand-up CDs, Circus People, It's Never Gonna Be Bread, This Will Make an Excellent Horcrux, and my brand new album, I Am Not the Hero of This Story. And they're all available as CDs on JackieCation.com. They're all available digitally on Amazon and iTunes, and you can just listen to them on Pandora and Spotify and whatever. So, but if you like hard copies, let me know if you want them signed or not. There's also a DVD of the Horcrux album, which is video. That's what a DVD is. And you can download that at ComedyFilmNerds.com if you just like a download. Okay, there are shirts. There's my stand-up shirt, Spooky Reading Girl. There's also two Dork Forest t-shirts. There's the Ranger of the Dork Forest t-shirt, and there is a Dork Forest logo shirt. And all the shirts are made in the United States, union-made, so they run a little big because they're made by Americans. Other than that, my stand-up is available on the website, on JackieCation.com. You can watch my Conan sets. You can watch a bunch of different stand-up sets. You can, and then you can see what my schedule's like. Enough of this. Let's get into the show. It's a really good one. Hey, it's Jackie Cation in my living room. It's 5 years and coming. Steve Agee, welcome to the program.
Hi, Jackie.
There you go. It's at Steve Agee, STEVEAGEE. And you have a couple of podcasts. You have Steve Agee, and you have a new one with Busy Phillips.
Yep. We're no doctors.
We're no doctors, where you speak of medicine.
Yeah. We're two hypochondriacs, neurotic actors who are obsessed with everything health-related.
Fantastic.
We know very little about what we're talking about.
Right. And that's the important thing, is that you just encourage, without information, speculation.
Yeah.
Fantastic. It's, were killed by Mary Poppins, yo.
Yeah, that's right.
In
spoilers, but yeah, that's
spoilers
right.
Spoilers in Guardians 2, and it was fun.
Yeah.
It was super fun to see you.
It's fun to do.
I bet. It was pretty great. Andy, my husband, was like, didn't Baby Groot kill him? And I was like, Mary Poppins, y'all.
Yeah, that arrow.
That arrow just came out of nowhere.
We shot actually a second scene where you see that I'm still alive that was supposed to be in the credits.
Oh.
One of those cut scenes in the credits. But James said it didn't make any sense. God damn it. I was like,
here's the thing about comic book characters. They can come back to life at any minute.
Yeah, exactly.
And did you see Wonder Woman?
Not yet. I'm going to see it this weekend.
Good times. Good times were had. Not enough pressure, of course, for it to be amazing.
I know, right?
DC side, lady side, all the sides. All the sides desperately wanting it to be a decent action movie.
I feel like there was no pressure because the DC movies haven't been doing so well, you know, and
well, they've been there's trouble, right?
Yeah.
So I thought that I walked in with a lot of pressure. I'm getting a lot of pressure from my DC fans going, this better work. And then I'm getting a lot of pressure from my internal feminist. Feminism is ruined if it isn't any good.
Yeah.
And so we don't want to ruin DC. We don't want to ruin feminism.
And it crushed.
And it crushed. And it was super fun, actually. It was who doesn't want to see a makeover? Where, Thor doesn't want to wear a dress.
Yeah.
Anyway, so.
I can't wait to see it. I'm really looking forward to it.
They did a nice job.
And I'm not an opening weekend guy. I don't like crowded theaters. I'm having a huge problem lately as well with just going to movie theaters because I get really annoyed with people on their phones.
Oh, yeah.
And that is almost a 100% guarantee going into, even if you're at Arclight where they like, say, please turn off your phones. And then they run the little scene at the beginning of
this is obnoxious. And
people still do it.
Right. You know, I haven't noticed it, actually. But where we go? We go in Van Nuys up here to what used to be called the greatest name, by the way, of any movie theater ever, Man Plant. It was a man theater.
Plant?
Man. And it's The Plant is the name of the strip mall, giant mall-y thing.
Oh, okay. Man Plant.
So it was called the Man Plant, and now it's called the Regency Plant because Regency bought the theater.
Right.
But the great thing is that you go to a movie in Van Nuys, you're going with families. You know, people who are shouting at the screen and kids.
Yeah, yeah.
And we went to a 6 o'clock on a Saturday, I think, or six, I don't know. It was 6 o'clock. It wasn't full. It was the second weekend. It was during the week or something. Something happened where it wasn't super full, but it was full of perfectly normal humans.
Yeah.
Which is what I want to see a movie with.
When I went to the Guardians premiere, because the movie hadn't come out yet, the premiere was the week before.
Yeah.
They made everyone going into the theater put their phones in these bags.
In the bags that Comedy
with
Works
locks
has?
On them.
With the locks?
Yeah. And I was like, this is great.
This is now that's
no phone. You see no phones.
No phones. People talk to each other. It's a beautiful thing.
And as soon as the movie is over, it's everybody rushing to the exits to get their phones unlocked.
Well, have you been to Comedy Works in Denver?
No, I haven't. They do that?
They do that.
Oh, my God.
And I was talking to the Ute that was were checking people's phones, because you get to keep your phone.
Yeah.
Just has a lock on it.
Yeah.
And I was like, are people vandalizing the bags? And they're like, oh, yeah. Yeah. There's people who write in pen, this fucking blows. People, some of them you just find under the table that have just been cut open.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, because people are out of their minds.
That.
Because you can put your phone on vibrate. If it vibrates, you can get up and leave the comedy club and have them open it. And then you're like, oh, my kid has a cough.
You know what's really weird about a phone on vibrate is it's still, not when you're performing, but it's still loud. Like, if I go to a meeting, I'll put my phone on vibrate.
Yeah.
And if there's a quiet moment and my phone vibrates, everyone can fucking hear it.
Yes. And everyone checks their phone. Because you're like, it could have been any of us. But, speaking of movies.
Uh-huh.
You have a dorkdom, and it involves
John Hughes,
but not all of John Hughes. It's not like Uncle Buck and Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Right, which I love, too.
The four classics.
The teen movies.
Which is now 16 Candles, 1984.
Yep.
Breakfast Club 85. And Weird Science.
Both, yeah.
Crazy. Ferris Bueller's Day Off, 86. That guy was working.
Those were his first four directorial films.
16 Candles was his directorial debut?
Yes.
Good Lord.
He wrote a shitload. In fact, a lot of people think he wrote more than, or directed more than he did.
Right.
Pretty in Pink, he did not direct, okay. Which everyone thinks he directed.
Did he write it?
He wrote it.
Okay.
He wrote Vacation.
Yeah.
National Lampoon's Vacation, which is
the
what...
The first one.
Mm-hmm, which is what got him 16 Candles.
Ah.
He did that and one other movie. I forget what it...
He did Home Alone.
Mr. Mom.
Did he write Mr. Mom?
He wrote Mr. Mom and Vacation, and those two movies are what got him his direct... Those got him a three-picture deal with Universal.
Wow.
And those first three movies were 16 Candles, Breakfast Club, and Weird Science. Yeah.
I've never seen Weird Science.
Oh, my God. Of those four,
yeah,
it's maybe my favorite.
Really?
Because yeah.
In 1985, I remember thinking to myself, this wasn't made for me. It reminded me of Porky's.
No, of course not.
I was like, also not made for me.
It was made for teenage boys.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And,
and it's completely fantastical and like...
Yeah.
It's science fiction. It's fully science fiction.
It's science fiction, yeah. But with a lady.
Yeah.
You're just like... Nerds make a lady.
They make a lady with a computer.
They make a lady with a computer, and it's good times.
And by the way, Ferris Bueller, which came after that in 86, is one movie, I think, that of all the movies I've seen in my lifetime, it's maybe one of like two or three that I remember what movie theater I saw it in.
Really?
I remember who I was with when I saw it. I remember where I was sitting in the theater.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off affected you so greatly.
Affected me incredibly.
So we're talking 1986. What city are you in?
I'm in Riverside, California.
All right.
Went and saw it with my friends, Chris and Tisha.
Okay.
We went to the Tyler Mall, to the movie theater at the Tyler Mall.
Yeah.
We sat halfway down.
Okay.
And it was one of the smaller theaters. It wasn't one where
when they started cutting them up?
Yeah, there was like one aisle and it's on, you know.
Right. I remember that.
And I sat on the aisle and we were halfway down the theater. And I was laughing so hard, me and my friend Chris. I sat next to Chris. Tisha was on the other side. I remember it like it was yesterday. We were laughing so hard, Chris and I were punching each other on the arms.
That's
while
how
shit was happening.
You literally were. It was a knee slapper, but an arm punch.
Yeah, that was a life changing.
That was a life changing movie. Ferris Bueller's Day, which the entire premise of it, I looked it up at IMDb, was a kid Hokey. Doesn't want to school, go to school.
Yeah.
Much to his principal's chagrin, or something like that.
Yeah, it's a kid who's playing hooky, like the ninth time. In fact, yeah, there's a line where. The principal's on the phone with Ferris's mom because he's playing sick and his parents think he's homesick. And he's like, he's looking at the computer and he goes, so far this semester.
Yeah.
Ferris Bueller has been absent 9 times.
Right.
And his mom's like, what? And he's like, it's right here in front of me. Meanwhile, at home, Ferris Bueller's on his computer changing that number. And Mr. Rooney, the principal, is watching the number go down while he's talking to the mom. And he's like, oh, this fucking kid.
And you like it better than War Games?
I don't even remember War Games.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
All right. Because of the computer thing. Because War Games changed my life. Yeah. Would you like to play a game?
Yeah.
But more than that is the code being like, I spent so much time in the principal's office when I was in high school.
Oh, me too.
And so... The fact that he knew where the code was to get into the computers for the...
I don't even remember that.
Yeah, it was like a breadboard kind of situation that slid out from the... We didn't have a computer. I mean,
I didn't either, no.
Yeah, I mean, I took a class on TRS-80s, Radio Shacks.
I did too.
Pretty sweet. I could write
I learned,
basic.
Was it DOS?
It was basic and DOS.
I learned how to program where you could make like a little person like... Do a pole vault over a...
In dot matrix?
Yeah.
Nice.
Something. And I worked all semester for this little 3-second
animated thing. I made a program that was a question and answer. It was like, if that, then this.
Yeah.
And it was, weirdly enough, online dating.
Really?
It was an online dating app.
So you created online dating before it was a thing.
And now I look at me reaping the benefit.
Yeah.
This is all the results.
Living in Van Nuys.
Living in a 2-1 in Van Nuys. But our victory garden's starting to produce tomatoes.
So oh, nice.
What are you hoping?
Well,
what are you hoping
good.
For more than that? Nothing.
Yeah.
So Ferris Bueller's Day Off, you see it. I was probably older than you. I had to be older than you during this Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And I never skipped school. So I remember thinking to myself.
I used to skip school.
Yeah, yeah.
And I would get busted, though. I remember one time.
Well, that's what it was then, maybe.
I remember one time I used to skip Spanish class a lot. And we had Spanish class was one year. It was in a trailer, like a trailer that was like. Kind of in the back of a field behind the school. You know how they would have...
Schools in California are weird because of the temperate climate.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's just like a weird Quonset hut that's been turned into it's just corrugated metal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I would have Spanish class in there, and several times... I mean, it was a full class, too. It's not like there's like 8 people. There'd be like 25, 30 people in that class. And when our teacher, Mrs. Ayala... would turn around to write something on the board, the door was right next to me. And like you said, because of the weather out here, the doors were always open to let the cool air in. I would just step outside and I would go to Taco Bell or 7-Eleven.
Lean against a wall.
For no reason other than I could.
Right.
And then I got busted. And if you got busted cutting class or being late to class, you would get a pink slip that you would have to go have your parents sign.
So they knew.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was the first time I ever forged my parents' name.
Wow.
I forged my mother's name.
Did it feel like a lesser evil?
It felt terrifying because I was like, I'm venturing into some uncharted territory. Right. Like, I'm getting them involved.
Right.
And this was at a time where my mother was out of town with my sister for like a month. And so it was just me and my dad at the house. And I, for some reason, signed my mom's name. And then they called the house and my dad answered. And he's like, no. He's like, Beverly is gone for a month. And they're like, oh, well, we have a signature. And so I had to go in and have a meeting with my dad.
Wow.
And then I had to do like free labor at the school and
sure, but extra time
digging ditches.
The only time I ever skipped, all I did was I because I was the editor of the school newspaper.
Uh-huh.
I would occasionally get to go to these events, and one of them was downtown. It was a convention. It was
journalism down
Milwaukee.
Oh, Milwaukee.
So it was outside of Milwaukee. I could go. I went to this weird journalism event because my advisor was like, You're gonna be a journalist. I see this, and so she was like, "You should go to this convention." And so I go to this convention, and I spend a half a day there, and it's mind-numbingly boring.
Yeah.
And then I go and see the Miles O'Keefe Tarzan movie twice. And
is that Greystoke?
Nope. It was just called Tarzan. It was with Bo Derek and Miles O'Keefe.
Oh my God, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so I think of it as the Miles O'Keefe Tarzan movie because he was freaking dreamy.
Yeah.
Not a word, by the way. Mum's the word from Tarzan on that one.
Yeah.
And then he wrestles a lion. Anyway, so
that's right.
Oh my God, I saw it twice.
Forgot about that movie,
and I never got caught except for I'm not good at lying, so I admitted it to my advisor, Mrs. Muldoon, and she was like, "You realize that you can't go to these. I can't sign off on you going to these things if you're not going to go to these things,
right?
Because then you're skipping school, and I always had this thing about you can't skip school. So Ferris Bueller." Drove me nuts.
Oh my
I was
God.
Like, just go to school.
It was so glorious.
It was glorious because he got away with it.
Yeah.
He not only got away with it, he got away with... Did he get away with everything?
He got away with everything. Car? I mean, his sister knew he was ditching. The principal knew he was ditching.
Right.
But they couldn't prove it.
He was in the parade.
Yeah.
I remember him being in the parade. And then did he go to a baseball game?
He went to God, was it like a Cubs game? They went to – it wasn't white. Yeah, it was definitely a Cubs game. He caught a fucking foul ball. Everything went his way. He caught a foul ball. He was in that I'm assuming it was probably like an Oktoberfest type thing, because there was like,
it was weird.
St. Pauli girl looking women on that float where he's singing Dunkashane in Chicago. Yeah.
So and then he trashes his friend's dad's car.
That's the one thing about this movie that always bothered me. Is I was like, he's kind of a dick.
Not even kind of. You're just like, kid, that's not your car.
He's doing it while his friend is pleading with him.
Pleading.
No.
Don't do that.
Please don't do this.
Yeah.
And he justifies it as at the end, or even while he's doing it, is like, you need this.
Yeah.
You need this to stand up to your father, even though it wasn't his plan to get caught or crash the car.
At all. And then and his friend actually, I mean, that would have been that's the Ender's Shadow, a game that's the movie I want to see.
Yeah.
Is the same movie from that kid's perspective.
Yeah.
And that's a drama.
Oh, that's a fucking that's a melodrama. That is like that hardcore.
That's child abuse and neglect.
Cameron is just a hypochondriac, and he's under his parents' thumb, and
right, and his dad's always gone, but they hate him,
fucking,
and just a tool bag. And you're just like, no. And then we're gonna destroy his car.
I actually would like to see that movie. You know. An additional half hour of that movie where he's dealing with his father. Like,
yeah. What's the follow up on that?
Like, what the fuck happened to my car? We took it into Chicago and, we couldn't get the odometer to roll back. So we tried putting it in reverse up on a jack, and, it fell off the jack and
into the lake.
Into a ravine. Behind the house.
Which is so weird because it's supposed to take place in Chicago.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've been to Chicago. Not a lot of ravines.
Well, it's the suburbs. It's the fictional town was Shermer, Illinois, is where all of John Hughes. Sure.
Oh, I did not.
It's not a real town, but like I believe all of his movies take place in Shermer, a place called Shermer.
Shermer, Illinois.
Which I don't know the actual town he's from. It's like North something, Northbrook or something, Illinois.
Right. Yeah. I'm sure it has an oak or a brook or a. Yeah,
but they filmed it they did a lot of filming locations. I don't know about Ferris Bueller's, but like, I think 16 Candles and,
I have to say Breakfast Club is my favorite of these.
You're not alone. A lot of people feel that way.
Yeah. Cause 16 Candles, because 16 Candles was just about, it was, kind of, I remember watching it and being relatively devastated. I was like, it's her birthday. Nobody remembers. Because of her crazy ass.
Basically,
sister.
Also, a girl gets raped, basically. Like, she's unconscious. The prom queen, Carolyn.
Right. And Anthony Michael Hall.
Yeah.
At the very least, it's date rape. It's,
yeah. She's inebriated. She's unconscious.
Well, but the thing is when she wakes up, she's just like, did we? And Anthony Michael Hall was like, I don't know. Doesn't he say, I don't know?
No, he goes, because he was fucked up too, and they wake up in the parking lot of the church.
In the Rolls or something.
In the back seat of the Rolls, by the way, which was John Hughes' actual car.
Okay.
he says, she's like, who are you? He's like, I'm Farmer Ted, because everyone called him Farmer Ted.
Right, right.
And he goes, did we...
Yeah.
And she goes, yeah, I'm pretty sure. So they never show that moment. So maybe she was awake for it. Either way, she was fucking drunk.
Yeah. She was drunk. He was drunk. I think that it was.
In fact, I wrote a treatment.
Yeah.
I think it's Julia Prescott who had a podcast or a show.
Okay.
Where you're pitching sequels to movies.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Do you remember that?
I do. I don't remember if it was her, but yeah, I remember that. It was.
I think it was Julia Prescott. I could be wrong. Yeah. God, yeah, I think it was Julia Prescott. And I pitched a sequel to...
to 16 Candles?
To 16 Candles called 16 Years, where Anthony Michael Hall goes to prison for raping a girl. I thought it was so funny. I wrote this whole treatment about him going to prison and getting out and trying to get revenge. And
like the girl most likely to?
Yeah, it's like...
Stalker Janning.
Yeah, it's like 16 years later, he's out of prison now.
They're both 32.
And I just remember going, oh, this is genius. And it's a comedy show, received? And it was not received well at
not
all.
Received
it was
well at all.
Silent.
Dead silence. Well, here's, okay, so what I know about date rape, which sadly, I've been date raped a couple of times, but the weird thing about date rape is that it happens, in my opinion, to me for sure, but other people, is when you're too young.
Yeah.
Because it's usually just some dude going, come on, let's
just pressured.
Fuck.
Yeah.
It's just pressured. Let's just do it until finally you're like, fine, fuck me and get out.
Exactly.
And so it's that. And then 10 years later, you wake up and go, wait, that was not actually consensual, you fuck.
Yeah.
And then the other time it happens is when it's pressured and you're super drunk. Either you're really young and you don't know how to say no, or you're really drunk and you're like, who cares? I don't want to do this.
Yeah, I'm all for the, 21-year-old drinking age. High school kids should not be drinking. Fucking college kids should not be drinking.
Well, and it's weird because the drinking age was 18 when I was 18. Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, in Wisconsin.
Oh, and, shit. I didn't know that.
But the thing
is, did they have a lower alcohol content?
It didn't matter. I just drank all the booze that there was.
Right.
But what I'm told now is that the reason why binge drinking is different now is because when I went out to the bar, I had to pay for every drink or get someone to buy me a drink, right?
Right.
When you go to a party and you're 18 or 16.
Oh my God.
You just buy a cup.
Yeah.
And you could drink all night for $10.
Yeah.
Which is why the binge drinking is a little worse, I think.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So if the drinking age were 18 and you're like, well, I have to find $20 if I want to get super fucked up.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's going to be, and not 20 anymore. You'd have to find 40 probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And half this movie, half this 16 Candles takes place at a party.
Yeah.
At Jake's house.
Yep.
His parents are gone. And it's
a solo cup. Yeah.
It is a heightened example of a teen party, but mm-hmm. not far off. I went to some parties in high school where it was just
a free-for-all.
Furniture getting broken, windows, and you're like, oh my God, I'm so glad this is not my house.
I had one of those. I went to – when I was in college, when I graduated from college, I lived in Massachusetts for a couple of summers, and we had this weird party that we all woke up the next morning, and we had a rental. And someone had knocked a hole in the wall and somebody else had broken the screen door. And I was like, this is a John Hughes movie.
Yeah.
Because you're like, who the fuck does that? Who goes to a party and just starts punching walls and ripping things up and stuff? But I guess some people do when they get hammered and it just gets grim. I remember that party where it felt super John Hughes because there was a couple making out leaning against the television. And I was like, not the television. That moves.
You move
to this wall, which didn't have a hole in it at that time.
Well, yeah. I mean, everything was taken to the 10th degree in those movies.
He didn't do Risky Business, did he?
No.
Okay. Because I know he did.
He did Planes, Trains. He did
Home
She's
Alone.
Having a Baby. Curly Sue.
Beethoven. He wrote the Beethoven.
He wrote the Beethoven franchise. Yep. Didn't direct them.
And anything that gets Charles Grodin work is on board for me.
I miss Charles Grodin.
I miss Charles Grodin. Did you know his daughter does stand up?
No.
Marion Grodin, but she's classic New York comic. So she never goes on the road. She's barely on.
Oh my God.
She was comic of the week on Jackie and Laurie with Kilmartin.
No
the
way.
Other podcast I do.
Yeah, yeah.
And because Laurie had just run into her, and she's like, "Yeah, I'm pretty good friends with her. She's a good egg, and she's really funny." And so she sent me a link to some of her stand up. She had done stand up on The View. Like she's
wow, yeah.
And but she only does like clubs in New York. Like she doesn't do the road or anything. And so, and I was like, "Well, how are we supposed to plug her?" She has a website.
Wow.
How are you going to?
It's rare to find a website anymore.
Yeah.
People are always like, go to my Twitter,
right,
go to my Facebook.
Steve Agee, by the way, it's just at Steve Agee, right?
Uh-huh.
And so just go to Twitter and Facebook.
And that's across
and
all the platforms, yeah.
Snapchat or whatever the hell.
Sure.
And just go find them. And then on Feral Audio, it's Steve Agee,
UHHH.
And we're no doctors. It's the new one. So that's hilarious. Yeah. But how about – see, now Breakfast Club I thought was the only one that had a real plot.
It was the only one that was actually grounded.
Yeah, like everybody had a story.
16 Candles was very unrealistic.
Yeah, it was just a romance novel, essentially.
Yeah, but Breakfast Club was – I dare say more dramatic than –
than
a
funny.
Comedy. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't think it was much of a comedy. It was, and it just, it had that like, you know, like, did he always have those scenes where there'd be a song playing and they'd jam? Or was that just Breakfast Club?
I mean, they're very soundtrack heavy.
Yeah, because that soundtrack was great.
Oh, my God, yeah. In fact, the Don't You Forget About Me, the Simple Minds song, was written for the movie.
Oh, really?
It wasn't one, like most of his soundtracks, he's taking pre-existing songs.
Yeah.
That song was written for Breakfast Club.
Okay. So, and that had Ally Sheedy,
mm-hmm.
who I...
As Allison.
Was Allison?
Uh-huh.
And so, it was like, so, okay, so Breakfast Club has the jock, Emilio Estevez.
Carl.
Awesome. Yeah. Allison.
I believe it's Carl. I haven't watched that movie in a long time, but right. Yeah, I think it's Carl.
And then Judd Nelson.
John Bender.
Is John. And but he was the tough guy. He was the burnout, right?
Yeah.
So burnout, John.
I heard he didn't get along with John Hughes at all. Like,
oh, yeah? Judd Nelson?
Like, some people had talked about maybe a sequel to that, and John Hughes was like, I'll never work with him again. Like, he was one of those method actors who would...
Oh, so he was a dick all the
time. In character and bully Anthony Michael Hall. Oh. And, in fact, I believe John Hughes almost fired him.
For doing it off
for
camera?
For being just a shitty person to work with.
Right. Yeah, yeah. It's keep your method to something.
Yeah. I don't know how much of any of this is true, but
right.
I mean,
it's hearsay. It's excellent hearsay. Yeah. You know, the Marathon Man hearsay with Dustin Hoffman and Laurence Olivier.
Yeah, great movie.
Is that I guess Dustin Hoffman was supposed to run, and mm-hmm. and Laurence and he did, and it was being explained to him why Dustin Hoffman looked like he had just run the actual thing. He's like, why doesn't he act? And
my God,
you're like,
that's so funny.
And it's a better story than that, but it's the short version. It's like when anybody asks me for a joke, I'm like, we're gonna retcon it back from the punchline.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna go through the joke with you. I'm gonna tell you the punchline, then I'm gonna tell you how it works. Because I'm having a hard time with jokes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So there's a goth chick.
Mm-hmm. Ally Sheedy.
And the jock and the burnout and the nerd. Oh, and then the popular girl.
Yes.
And which?
Molly Ringwald.
Molly Ringwald.
I worked on a movie with Molly Ringwald.
Oh, interesting. And you got to meet Molly Ringwald.
One scene. It was a scene with a lot of people. So I know, I didn't really talk to her. I just said hello. And
Right.
Well, inside I was dying and wanted to ask her 10 gazillion questions.
Yeah. It's Kilmartin did Conan the other night.
Mm-hmm.
And
killed. I saw it. She was great. Yeah.
Because you got a standing ovation. I was standing on the side because we recorded that episode there. But the other two, did you watch the whole episode with the other two guests?
No.
Because it was Patty Jenkins who directed Wonder Woman.
Right.
And there was absolutely no reason and no way that I could have gotten introduced to Patty Jenkins. So I just kind of stood there and was like, yeah, I'd really like to meet her. But then you wonder, what are you going to say? I mean, you just say,
exactly.
I really like your work.
You turn into that Asperger fan who talks to you after a show. And you're like,
yeah,
make this end.
And right, which, you know, she was super polite because people came up and the greatest interaction was one of the camera people from Conan was mm-hmm. a woman. And she was like, I'm just hoping I was going to get, we have a poster. Could you sign the poster? And I'm one of the camera people. And then Patty Jenkins was like, I did camera on TV for 10 years. And then they had a real conversation.
Whoa.
And so that was neat.
That's great.
It's kind of cool to just witness. I was just standing there.
That's
and then
awesome.
The other guest was the actress from Mad Max Fury Road who played one of the breeders.
Oh, do you know which one? Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah.
Chloe or...
Yeah.
And she's in a new horror movie. So, but they were both very funny. And there was nothing... It was... Yeah, they... I mean, I was just standing. There's no end to that story.
I remember shooting something for this. It was a weird, I did this really weird experimental movie. I don't even know where you would find it. It's called Me.
Me.
And then the director is this guy, oh my God. Jeff Levy.
Oh, okay.
Levy?
Maybe.
Jeffrey Levy.
Right.
And, He directed a bunch of TV and stuff in like the 90s, and he directed a movie with Steven Dorff, which I can't remember the name of, like
right.
STFO, I think, something like that.
Okay.
But he's got a lot of friends. So he did this really experimental movie, and he called in all these favors, like Gina Gershon's in it, and
Molly Ringwald,
E from the Eels is in it, Jennifer Jason Leigh.
Wow.
And
the guy from the Eels.
Yeah.
It's I have that album.
Oh, it's great. He's great. And but I was shooting something, and he just used his we shot at his house, and
yeah.
And so I'm in this room and we're shooting something, and Molly Ringwald walked in.
Yeah.
And I was like, Jesus Christ, that's Molly Ringwald. Like, I was so fanboying out.
Right. Because, did you have a favorite character of the Breakfast Club?
I always liked Anthony Michael Hall. In the Breakfast Club, I don't know. I mean, honestly my least favorite of his movies.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know why. Probably because it wasn't crazy enough for me.
Right,
because
the other three are genuinely goofy. Like,
oh my God, they're goofy. Makes a lady with a computer? Yeah, that's a little goofy. Ferris Bueller even is.
Who's in Weird Science? I don't even know. Oh, Bill Paxton.
Bill Paxton.
I wrote down Bill Paxton. Who did he play?
He plays the brother, Chet. He plays Wyatt's brother, Chet. And Wyatt was played by this guy, Elon Mitchell something. One of those three names. Okay, I don't think he did.
Three names, and he has Mitchell in the middle.
I think he maybe did one other movie after that.
And then who was the lead in Weirds? I mean, it was Kelly LeBrock.
Well, Anthony Michael Hall and Kelly LeBrock.
It was Anthony Michael Hall.
And Robert Downey Jr.'s in it.
Oh, he probably plays...
He plays one of the...
Slow clap jock guy? Or not even? Not a bad guy? Or
he's kind of a foil. Yeah, I don't even know if you'd call him a bad guy. He's just a dick. He's a foil to Anthony Michael Hall and
the other guy.
And the other guy, Wyatt, Gary and Wyatt's characters. And he had a friend. I can't remember the actor's name. He was in one of the Friday the 13th movies. Okay. Or no, not Friday the 13th. One of the Freddy, the Nightmare on Elm Street movies.
Okay.
And so those two guys are like the foils. And
And so were they just regular nerd? Like Anthony Michael Hall is just playing another nerd character, right?
They're just nerd. Well, the movie starts out. The cold open is the cold open is you see a girl's gym class. The girls are doing gymnastics and calisthenics in the gym,
right?
And then you pan around and you see Gary and Wyatt standing in the door, just watching them, going, "Oh man,
girls,
look at these girls!" And like, and they have two that they like.
Right.
In particular, who happened to be Robert Downey Jr.'s girlfriend and the other guy's girlfriend.
Oh, okay.
And so they're like, those two girls right there. Those dames right there.
Dames.
You know, they talk about parting with them. And then yep. Anthony Michael or Robert Downey Jr. and his buddy are standing directly behind them,
right,
unbeknownst to Anthony Michael Hall and his buddy. And they pants them in front of the girls' gym. They pull down their pants and yell, "Hey, look at us!" And then they hide.
Right.
And so all the girls turn around and it's just these two nerds in their underwear.
Right.
And that just kind of sets up who these guys are.
Yep. Yeah, that'll set it up right there.
These nerds who don't get laid, don't have girlfriends.
Right. But at least they didn't get pantsed all the way down to their non-shorts.
And so they're watching, they're watching Frankenstein, I believe. And they see, you know, they're watching the scene where he brings Frankenstein to life. And Anthony Michael Hall's like, "What if we do that? Let's make a girl on your computer."
Okay. He's got a Commodore.
They're like, they just want to make a simulation on a computer that they can talk to. It's so goofy. And then they hook it up to jumper cables and a battery. And
all of a sudden, Zort, and she appears? Yeah. Or
she comes out of the bathroom. Like, there's a big explosion, and then the door.
Why the bathroom?
I don't know.
That's weird. Because
why anything?
Right, anything. Right, because the computer's in their bedroom, right?
But it like dims the lights in the whole town while it's happening, and
sure,
like there's dogs standing on ceilings in someone's kitchen, and
we're gonna get to the spoiler alert on this thing because I need to know how this ends. But so she shows up, and she's probably fake naked, right? Is she always fake naked?
She's in like gym clothes. She's in like
weird.
Aerobics. She's basically in like an aerobics outfit.
Oh, she's a
like a mid shirt, like showing her belly.
Buns of steel.
Yeah.
She's that lady. Okay.
Yeah.
And does she have big hair, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, she has big hair.
Because it's 85 or 80.
It's 85.
85. And so They're like, oh my God. So now, and is it in Anthony Michael Hall's house or the other guy's
house? It's in Wyatt's house, his buddy's house. Okay. His parents are gone. There's always, you know, the parents are gone.
This is very Charlie Brown. The and parents then, are never around.
But there's also the conflict of Gary's or Wyatt's brother, Chet.
Oh, right. The older brother.
Played by Paxton.
Yep.
Is home from military school. And he's just a douche.
Oh, God.
So he's the other foil in this movie.
Is he? So.
And he just extorts money from. I remember that's the thing. They come home drunk one night. The first night they go out and party with this girl.
Right, because she could buy liquor.
Lisa,
probably.
Yeah. And
will they name her Lisa?
That's the other thing. They're driving in a car that she makes. She can make anything. She makes this big pink Cadillac. And they're driving to a bar, and they go, "What's your name?" And she's like, "You guys made me. You get to name me, or you guys made me. You get to name me." And Anthony Michael Hall's like, "How about Lisa?"
Oh
and
my God!
And she's like, "Why Lisa?" And then Wyatt's like, "He used to like a girl named Lisa. She kicked him in the nuts." And it's just a girl that fucking hates him. Like they name him after a girl that hates him.
I like just
but she apparently lives in Canada, which is, I think, an ongoing bit for his character. Like,
oh, the girl he likes.
16 Candles, he likes a girl who lives in Canada, too.
Sure, sure. Why? Yeah. Well, and
Canada.
Let me tell you about growing up in Milwaukee. It was always
You're
the
very
joke.
Close to Canada.
We're very close to Canada, as is Chicago. And it's an ongoing joke in all high schools that you have a secret girlfriend or boyfriend
in Canada.
Who lives in Canada. And they're like,
We carried it out in at least two of these movies.
Good for you, John Hughes, for bringing it forth.
Yeah, so they come home from a night at a bar, and they're both, like, super drunk, and Chet's just like, you know, $75 in unmarked bill. Like, he's extorting money from him. Or,
from
I want your VCR.
Brother.
And or then they find out, like, later in the movie, like, she makes his grandparents catatonic. Like, they come and crash the party. And so she freezes them. And they're in a closet.
What?
Do you remember? Have you?
No.
Oh, you haven't seen this
I've
movie.
I've never seen it. So,
oh, my God. Yeah.
Okay. So we have... We have the two kids, and Wyatt's older brother is played by Bill Paxton.
Paxton, yeah.
And
a military school kid. He's got a buzz cut.
He's got, and he's just a tool bag.
He's a horrible brother. And extorts money.
Right.
Whenever he finds out some dirt, he's like, you owe me. And
now I need cash.
And so, yeah, the first night they make this girl, they go to a bar, and they get just shit-face drunk, especially Anthony Michael Hall. They come home. They wake up the next day, and they're like, did that even happen? Like, they're like, oh, I think I was so drunk I imagined we made a girl.
And then she comes out of the bathroom again?
No. And
where
then,
does she live?
Just in that house now.
Right.
She's living
Bill
in this
Paxton
house.
Doesn't know that she's there?
No.
So she's got it. I say she's in the bathtub. I say she's got blankets and a pillow, just chilling in the bathroom.
And so they go to the mall with her the next day, and they're walking around. And she puts them, like, she just thinks something, and it's there. Like, so they're in, like, these really cool, they're in hip clothes now. So they have hip haircuts, hip clothes, and they go to the mall, and they're like, and they're sitting down in the mall at one point, and in these, like, cool clothes.
Right.
And Wyatt, who's the other kid, says to Gary, he's like, for the first time in my life, I don't feel like a total dick. And as soon as he says that, Robert Downey Jr. and his buddy are standing up on the upper level of the mall with big Slurpees, and they just dump them on their heads. And so and everybody in the mall is laughing. Of course, it's that moment where everybody turns and is laughing at them.
Right. It's like a bad nightmare.
And those two guys, girlfriends who become the love interest of Anthony Michael Hall
and Wyatt.
Yes. So they're really they're kind of like,
why are
in
you
fact,
guys
they have a moment
jerks?
Where they go aside and they're like, why are we dating these jerks? We should break up with them. And then one of the girls is like, but then we won't be popular and we won't get invited. They're really shallow girls.
Yeah, yeah. It's, all four of them seem pretty bad.
And then, Robert Downey Jr. and this other guy are like walking through the mall, and they're going down the escalator as Kelly LeBrock is going up. And she's like, obviously the hottest girl in this mall. And they're just staring at her. And she like kind of like blows them a kiss as they're walking by. And so, that now they're following her, and they follow her outside the mall, and they're like, so what are you doing? God. And she's like waiting for my ride. And they're like, they're trying to hit on her. And yep. she's having none of it. She's like totally giving them the cold shoulder. Mm-hmm. And then you hear this Porsche drive. This Porsche drives up and it's Gary and Wyatt.
Yeah.
And they get out and they're like, Lisa, hon, come on. We're going to be late. And it's a total fuck off to Robert Downey Jr.
And
his buddy. And
yeah, and then what happens?
And oh, and she goes, Gary and Wyatt are having a party tonight at
yeah.
And this sets up the whole movie basically. She's like, there's a party at Wyatt's house tonight. Look him up in the student directory. And Gary and Wyatt are like, party?
Yeah.
And so then basically the whole movie, they're like, we don't have any friends. No one's going to show up to this party. And I'm skipping a lot of shit. They're in his house, and then all of a sudden you hear the doorbell ring.
And it's
and
everybody.
They open the door, and it is the whole fucking school. and then it cuts to, it's like the other party in 16 Candles.
Yeah.
It's fucking mayhem.
Right, right. People are losing their minds. The music is incredible.
And Gary and Wyatt are hiding in the fucking bathroom because they're too scared to deal.
Overwhelmed.
Yeah. And so she's like, Lisa, Kelly LeBrock, is like, I got to fucking make these guys step up and like do something brave and like. And so she like snaps her finger and all of a sudden these mutants from like Mad Max. And they are literally the characters from it's the
like
one
zombies or something.
No, no. It's the one main guy. I forget his name, the actor's name, who played like the bad guy in Road Warrior.
Yeah.
Like the Mohawk guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The actual actor played him. He revised his role for this. Like he shows up.
What?
And
what
they're
the fuck
fucking,
is this movie?
They come through the windows on motorcycles, and these like leather-clad fucking mutants are like just driving around the house, beating people up, tearing it up. And so Kelly LeBrock goes into the, these guys are now hiding in a closet at this point, and she's like, you have some unwanted guests, and they're like, not our problem. She's like, they're fucking up the house. You got to deal with these guys, and they're like, nope.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, one of the guys like punches through the wall and grabs the two nerds and brings them out. And they're like,
right.
And then they're threatening the girls. And finally, they just stand up to,
stand up to
the mutants, mm-hmm. pull out a gun that he thinks is a squirt gun, which later is an actual. This doesn't make any sense.
Right.
Telling
no,
it, but
no.
The movie doesn't make any sense.
No, and it doesn't have to.
And so they prove themselves, you know, in front of these girls.
They rise to the occasion.
And then it cuts to later, the house is empty and the girls are there and they, you know.
The place is trashed.
Trashed. They make out with the girls.
They make out with the Robert Downey Jr. girls?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. When the mutants show up in the house, Robert Downey Jr.'s buddy leave. They're just like.
Oh, they run.
They're like, let's get out of here. And he's like, what about the girls? And he's like, girls, schmirls. We don't see them for the rest of the movie. They're done.
They're done. That's the end of that one. And
there also is a point during this party where Wyatt's grandparents show up and they're like these proper older, very like mid-Atlantic sounding, like, well, let's go visit Wyatt. And they walk in and they're hitting people and like going, who are you? Get out of our grandson's house. And,
oh my God.
And so Kelly LeBrock freezes them and puts them in a closet. And also, at some point, the kitchen is blue, like everything in the kitchen. Cabinets, floor, ceiling, windows, dishware, everything is blue. People's clothes are blue. Anyone in the kitchen is just blue.
What?
Yeah, it's fucking bananas.
It is bananas. I wonder if it's on Netflix. Now I need to kind of see it. What the?
Yeah, and so Chet comes home. Chet was out, I think, hunting overnight. Like. So he wasn't home when this was happening. He comes home the next morning. He walks in the house. He's like, what the fuck? And he's got a big shotgun because he was like duck hunting.
Right.
And so he walks into his room. He opens his room and it's fucking snowing inside of his room. And he's like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
And so he goes and he finds Anthony Michael Hall and he like wakes him up. He's laying in bed with this girl. And he's like, it's snowing in my fucking room. What is going on? Where's Wyatt? He finds Wyatt. He finally corrals everybody and brings them down into the kitchen.
Okay. The four of them and Kelly LeBrock?
And Kelly LeBrock.
Okay.
And it's just this big confrontational moment. And he's walking around, like, yelling at everybody. And then he goes to the cupboard and he opens, like, the pantry. And there are his grandparents. And he's like, hey, Nanny, hey, Grampy. And then he walks away and then he freezes and he's like, are those my grandparents? And so he tells Gary and Wyatt to take their little hussy girlfriends home. He's like, get rid of it. Take them home. I'm going to talk to this girl, Kelly LeBrock.
Yep.
And get to the bottom of this. And so they take the girls home. And
In the Porsche that was made out of nothing.
In a Porsche made out of nothing and a Ferrari that now – she's like, Gary, you take the Porsche. Or she's like, Wyatt, you take the Porsche. Gary, you take the Ferrari. He's like, Ferrari? And all of a sudden a Ferrari appears in the driveway. It's fucking bananas.
It is banana land.
And so there's a moment between Chet and Kelly LeBrock in the kitchen where she's like, I'm a serious bitch. You don't want to fuck with – she's like, you really have to be a better brother to Wyatt. And he's like, oh, what are you going to – what are you going to do? And she basically turns him into a giant pile of shit. Like,
what?
Which they did with like puppetry and like animatronics. There is literally like the size of this chair in your living room. Like, it's like
a pile of poop.
He's like a pile of shit with like a mouth and eyes and arms.
What the
and,
fuck?
And so by the time Gary and Wyatt come back, he's like, I'm sorry, I've been such a shit to you all these years. And he's like,
what? It's so funny because it came out the same year as Breakfast Club.
I know. And by the way,
we're just threw it together.
I mean, there's rumors. It says on IMDb, I believe it says that he wrote this movie in 2 days, which I would believe. I would believe that he wrote this movie in 2 days.
Yeah, me too.
That's a rumor that has, I think, been applied to most of those movies. It says on IMDb he wrote 16 Candles in 2 days. It says he wrote
Weird Science
in 2 days, Breakfast Club in 2 days. Ferris Bueller's, it says he wrote in 6 days.
Wow.
But I think he really only wrote one of those movies in 2 days.
Right.
I would say it was probably Weird Science.
Yeah, Weird Science seems like the one.
Because it's just...
It's so, but it's
leads
crazy.
You know, act one leading into this act two party. And,
yeah. So what's act three? How is there even an act three?
Well, reconciling, you know, Wyatt and his brother reconciling, Kelly LeBrock proving to them that they, you know,
don't need her.
They don't need her. They stood up to these guys and now they have girlfriends and, And then they say goodbye to her. They're like, what about you? And she's like, I'll be fine. And, you know, there's this tearful moment of them saying goodbye to her. And she kind of walks out. And then everything in the house just starts going in reverse. Like a missile at one point came up through the floor of the house. Like and out the ceiling. Like a Pershing missile. A gigantic, like, three-story missile is sticking out of the house. And, you know, as soon as she leaves and everything has been – reconciled, the missile goes through the floor, you know, furniture starts reversing and all that's happening as the parents are pulling up into the driveway, getting out of the car, getting their luggage, and as they walk in the door, like, just you see this end table quietly slide up to the wall, and that's the last piece. And
right.
Yeah, and then the parents are like, so your dad was worried you guys would have a party this weekend. And they're like, oh, no, not us.
Not us.
And then the tag at the end of the movie is, you know, you see a guy's gym class and you hear a whistle and they all turn around and it's Kelly LeBrock. And she's in that same original outfit of like the the half top and the aerobics clothes. And she's their gym coach or whatever.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
But that's great. I love that movie.
That movie sounds like it could be a mess, but you're like, nope, it just keeps going, and then it all wraps up.
It totally embraces the just the absurdity of it all. Like it doesn't take itself seriously.
Well, that's what I like about it because Risky Business does.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like Risky Business.
Kind of, yeah.
Except for that, it's
no whores.
No whores. It doesn't take itself, and then. And Real Genius, which I love Real Genius.
I could have almost talked about Real Genius.
Well, Real Genius is amazing, quite honestly.
It's a movie I still will watch like every few months. I own it. I'll put it on and just watch it if I can't sleep.
Oh, that's kind of cool. It's that's sort of it's Weird Science, but with an arc. I mean, the popcorn scene alone in Real Genius.
Yeah, that's really, I mean, kind of one of the only fantastical, like, this would never happen moments. But, like, everything else, I mean, I guess there's a lot of, like, where they pave the inside of the dorm in ice. And go
ice skating. But they're supposed to be geniuses and scientific nerds.
Yeah,
and
it's all about the, you know,
experimentation and
or the horrible shit. And I mean, I think it's based on, you know, like inventing, you know, scientists inventing the atom bomb basically as a mistake, and all of a sudden we have nuclear
weapons. Yeah,
weapons. It's kind of like, you know, mirroring that. You know, they make these lasers that are supposed to be used for weapons,
And then you see the reveal from space, and then there's the guy who does all the contests.
Oh, yeah, Laszlo Holyfeld, played by John Grease, who is Uncle Rico in Napoleon Dynamite.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that guy's been acting for forever.
He reminds me of the Naked Trucker.
Kind of. Yeah, Dave Gruber Allen.
Dave Gruber. And Gruber Allen. And then, did you ever see No Small Affair?
No, I don't know what that is.
Well, you know, the dirtbag sitcom, Two Dads or something?
My Two Dads.
Yeah, it's with Sheen, Charlie Sheen, and it's...
Oh, no, Two and a Half Men.
Two and a Half Men, yeah. Who's the other guy?
John Cryer.
John Cryer, is it a movie?
Ducky from Pretty in Pink.
Oh, there you go.
Written by John Hughes.
Exactly. So John Cryer and Demi Moore, when it was Demi, and pre-boob job, are in a movie called No Small Affair, where he is a nerd boy, and she is an actress... And he falls in love with her, and he takes all of his money for photography class that he's going to go to photography so that she can be famous by putting her phone number on and her picture on billboards with no explanation. And she's like
Angeline.
Right, right. Yeah. I think it's an Angeline parable.
Yeah.
But he spends all and I can't remember how that movie, but I love No Small Affair.
I honestly could have. You know, when you asked me to pick a thing I'm geeky about, I mean, first thing I went to was John Hughes, but any one of those 80s teen movies, like Last American Virgin, Losing It, Real Genius, Better Off Dead, John Cusack. Oh my God.
Right. What was the one with the,
and then One Crazy Summer with
Peter Gabriel? Song?
Oh, yeah, that was...
Space Case. I've seen it 1,000 times. And I love it because, you know, I don't want to buy anything. I don't want to sell anything. I don't want to process anything.
Yeah.
I don't want to buy anything, bought or processed.
All those movies.
Yeah.
And, I mean, the whole Brat Pack era.
Yeah.
In fact, you know, in Breakfast Club, when they shot Breakfast Club... Molly Ringwald and Anthony Michael Hall were the only teenagers. Everyone else, Judd Nelson, Emilio Estevez, were like 23 to like 25 or 26. And that same year, those three actors, Ali Sheedy, Emilio Estevez, and Judd Nelson, did St. Elmo's Fire the same year as college students.
Oh, really?
So they played high school students and college students the same exact year.
Oh, wow. So, but Molly Ringwald and Mike,
Anthony Michael Hall were 16.
We're actually 16?
Yeah.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Wow. That is weird.
In fact, also in 16 Candles, I mean, they were still 16. I mean, they did these movies so close to each other.
Right. That was 84. 84
into 15. 85. Yeah. And, it was the guy who played Jake, the big dreamy hunk, was like, he was like 26. No, I think he was 24.
Right.
That actor was 24. And the girl who played Caroline, or Carolyn or Caroline?
She had to be over 18 because
she was in her, she was like 23.
Yeah, because there's a nude scene in the shower with her.
Well, that was a body double.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
I had forgotten because I had only seen the movie 16 Candles on cable.
Yeah.
And they had cut out the boob shot.
Of course.
On cable. And I was babysitting. Here in Los Angeles, when I first moved here in 97 or whatever, I babysat for this kid until probably 2001. And Caitlin was probably 11 or 12. And I was like, oh, you would love 16 Candles.
Yeah.
And so I bought the VHS, and they had a VCR, and I pop it in, and all of a sudden, it's the shower scene.
Oh, my God,
like,
yeah.
And she calls for her little brother, which is such a weird thing for Caitlin to do, because she was probably 12 at the time, and she goes, Cole, get down here. And
that's amazing.
Yeah, and so Cole, like, bolts downstairs, and I have turned off the movie, and I was like, you get to see boobs. Not on my watch.
Yeah.
Not on my watch. And it didn't matter, because he had HBO in his room.
It's also such a dated movie, you know, like... They have the Asian stereotype Long Duck Dong.
Long Duck Dong,
like,
in the
really,
tree.
I think he caught a lot of shit for Getty Watanabe playing...
Oh, the actor?
The actor Getty Watanabe, who played Long Duck Dong, like, got a lot of hate from, like,
Asian groups
watch and, groups. And
yeah, but at least it wasn't played by Andy...
Mickey Rourke.
Mickey Rooney.
I mean, Mickey Rooney. Mickey Rourke.
Or Andy Rooney.
Or Andy Rooney. But yeah, I mean, it's got that, you know, every time you talk... Every time someone says Long Duck Dong, you hear a gong.
Yes. It's the worst. It's genuinely...
You know, and it's... I mean, with a lot of 80s teen movies, you know, they say fag.
Yeah, there's...
You know, Anthony Michael Hall, when they... His two buddies... John Cusack and the other guy are afraid to go into the party. He's like, stop being such fags.
Right. It's the 80s was chock full of this.
Oh my
and
God.
And Porky's with the peephole and all this stuff. Even Valley Girl.
Yeah.
Had like, just crazy weird. The racism and and the sexism is thick on the ground, you guys.
Yeah.
Grain of salt. If you're going to watch any of these movies.
Yeah. 70s and 80s. Someone was telling me they saw, Blazing Saddles. They like it was showing it like the New Beverly or something.
Yeah,
my friend,
and they had never seen
or at the ArcLight, they did a re-release of it. My friend went to saw it and he said everyone who's you know was in like their 40s, who's our age, was laughing their ass off at the movie. He said all the millennials in the theater were just like
what?
Shocked at you know how often the N-word is said in that movie.
Right, right, and it's
you couldn't do it.
You couldn't do it today.
You couldn't do it today.
But did you see the Will Ferrell Mexican one?
No.
In Spanish?
No.
It was as close as you could get. The only problem with that movie, quite honestly, because it was hilarious. I own it.
Uh-huh.
I forget what it's called, like Casa de whatever.
Yeah.
And because it's a great Mexican parody along the lines of Blazing Saddles.
Yeah.
The only problem with it was the casting of Will Ferrell, just because he's too old.
Right.
They should have found like the guy who played the sheriff in Blazing Saddles. They should have gone with someone younger.
Yeah.
And it would have been fine. But it was, I almost laughed till I cried.
It's all in Spanish, right?
It's all in Spanish and it's freaking hilarious. And, but it's darkly funny. And then there's another movie called, A Day Without a Mexican, which well, it's an indie movie and it's a one joke premise.
Yeah.
What happens is one day all the Mexicans in California disappear.
Oh, so we have no food. No one's
just
picking our fruit.
Just car washes are empty and the water runs.
Yeah,
and people like strollers go off into traffic.
Was it the whole thing about you know how people are always like they're taking our jobs and it's like they're jobs that you would never fucking do, you asshole.
Right. It was just one asshole statistic after another. It was and sometimes and spoiler alert on A Day Without a Mexican, but only because
spoiler alert. Don't spoil it for me.
Spoil from 5 years ago or 10 years ago.
Yeah.
I saw it at ArcLight. It was an indie film, and there was one woman who was a Mexican woman who happened to be who had been left behind, and she was like, "Why have I been left behind?" And the big reveal is that she's Armenian.
Armenian. Jesus Christ, that's crazy.
Yeah, it was awesome. She had been adopted into this Mexican family. And and she was like, why didn't they take me? And,
I'm Armenian.
Yeah. And then it turns out she was like, I'm Armenian. What? It was kind of awesome.
That's rad.
It was pretty rad. Steve Agee, it's been an hour. And,
oh my God, I could talk about John Hughes stuff for...
Yeah, there's 19 other movies and just
I picked those four because I was a teenager. Those
they were perfect.
Movies were happening when I was that age,
right?
And so you know I can still look at them even though they're dated and watch them and like
yeah
I'm like that's what high school was. That's the cliques and the fashion and the music.
I love Willow more than anyone.
Oh my God. And out of the way, Peck.
Oh my God. So a Peck with an acorn.
Yeah.
I'm terrified.
Yeah.
It's a use the wand, Willow. Anyway.
And John Hughes is, by the way, the only director that when they died, I cried. I was like,
really?
I was so sad that he died, even though he hadn't, you know, mm-hmm. he hadn't directed anything since Curly Sue, which was, you know,
91,
like 91, maybe.
Yeah.
And, yeah, it was really sad.
It's a tragic loss.
Yeah.
Luckily, we have his works.
Absolutely.
And
oh my God, what a legacy.
Steve Agee, everyone, go see him wherever he can be found. You can follow him on Twitter and Instagram and
yes.
all the things
yes.
at Steve Agee, A-G-E-E.
Yep.
Thanks for doing the show, man.
Thanks, Jackie.
And Rangers, you know the rules out there. Take care of each other.
My hat, my hat, my hat. They're dancing around my hat. My hat, my hat, my hat. Well, what do you think of that? If it looks like a Mexican hat dance and it sounds like a Mexican hat dance, it's most likely a Mexican hat dance. So take off your hat and let's dance.
Yay! Oh my God. Why don't we just call that as the end of the show?